Have you ever been anxious? What if I told you that you're anxious because you're trusting in the wrong thing? Today on Cross Connection, we will learn how to trust Jesus is so much better. Welcome to Cross Connection. We are so glad you have joined us today, and we continue our study of the Gospel according to Luke.
That's right, and as we continue, our theme today is, where is your heart? Today's passage in Luke concludes with, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And one of the fundamental pieces of good news about the Gospel is that we are Jesus' treasure, and He is our treasure. So why do we have such a hard time trusting Him and entrusting God? Today, we'll tackle that question and more with the help from you, our fourth guest.
And we are joined today by Jitesh, Claudia, and Marlon. Thank you so much for being a part of our discussion.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, you see, I can always see that you're excited, so thanks for being there. And I hope you're also excited because you're also a part of our discussion.
Absolutely.
So pick up your Bible, because we all have our Bibles. Lift them up.
Mm, yes.
Yeah, we all have our Bibles. So, and then what we will do, we will continue studying the Gospel of Luke, and we will see Jesus so much better.
Yeah.
And have you ever wondered why there are four Gospels in the Bible?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No, because the message about Jesus Christ is so important.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are we don't see four books of Genesis,
right,
or four
right
books of Moses.
Yeah.
I mean, there's five books of Moses, but they don't all tell the story about Moses,
yeah,
and
right
so forth. What we do see, we see that it's so important to understand who Jesus is.
Yeah. 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 I only wish there were more.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. So what we will do, we will continue our study of the Gospel of Luke. And before we do that, let us pray. And Claudia, could you lead us in prayer?
Sure. Heavenly Father God, we just praise you and thank you so much for your word and for the opportunity to study it. Mm-hmm. We pray and ask that the Holy Spirit just continue to fill us and continue to enlighten us, yes, so that we may truly understand what it is that we must do to be saved. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. So we are in Luke chapter 12.
Yes.
Oh, we are moving forward.
Wow.
So chapter 12. And before we start our study, we always look back.
Yeah.
So, and I would like us to look back all the way to like two episodes back.
Wow.
Because it is very important. So Sergio, what did we talk about two episodes back? And I hope you also remember what we talked about. So,
as our viewers know, it was the beginning of chapter 11. Mm-hmm. And the theme was internal transformation.
Mm-hmm.
So we start with the model prayer, then receiving the Spirit, being persistent in expecting God's goodness, mm-hmm, and tidying up your heart, so to speak, and then repentance.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then, so last time on Cross Connection, what did we talk about, Claudia? Because you were a part of it as well.
Well, we were talking about hypocrisy,
uh-huh,
and the need to be authentic in our mm-hmm Christianity.
Mm. Excellent, mm, excellent, yeah, excellent summary. And so today Luke presents us this a very dilemma, kind of.
Mm.
He says, okay, where is your heart now?
Yeah.
So
yeah,
we talked about internal transformation, we talked about hypocrisy, but now it's a very important decision that you need to make, mm, the reader, the hearer, the viewer.
Yeah.
We all need to make this decision. Where is our heart now?
Mm.
So
wow,
let's get into the Word.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we're in Luke chapter 12, mm-hmm, and let us start with reading verses 1 and 2. And Sergio, could you read verses 1 and 2?
Yeah. In the meantime, when an innumerable multitude of people had gathered together so that they trampled one another, he began to say to his disciples, first of all, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. For there is nothing covered that will not be revealed, mm-hmm, nor hidden that will not be known.
Wow. Okay, so what is the reminder of Jesus to all of his disciples when more and more and more people know and see their Christianity, kind of?
Mm-hmm.
So imagine this, the disciples are gathered.
Yeah.
And many other people are there.
Mm-hmm.
So Jesus does not talk to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
He talks to whom?
The disciples.
To his disciples. Mm. Why do you think he talks to his disciples when the crowd is around?
Mm.
Well, you can't help but notice the two things, right? I mean, Luke goes into this kind of literary detail on mm-hmm the crowd. Isn't it? There's a lot of people there. Mm-hmm. There's so many that they're mm trampling one
yeah
another. There's
yeah
so many people
yes
there, Luke highlights. Mm-hmm. And then he turns to his disciples and says, careful now. Careful. Don't let your hearts become corrupted.
Yeah, so mm why do you think careful?
I think it's so tempting when there's a lot of people, when you're on show, if you will, mm-hmm. to not be yourself. And he's saying, you know, we had an experience with him teaching what not to be like. So mm-hmm. yeah. don't be like the Pharisees, just kind of a mm-hmm. reminder. That's, you know, it's almost like a parent reminding a child.
Yeah, don't be hypocrite.
I think
yeah.
of a few episodes ago when disciples are sent out and they cast out demons and they come back and they're so excited that mm-hmm. these demons are subject to us. Right. Like, we own these demons and they're so right. excited about that. Mm-hmm. And Jesus says, careful. Mm-hmm. Don't have that be the thing that you're excited about. I feel a little bit of that here in this as well.
Yeah. I can only imagine. If I was one of the disciples, I would probably be as close to Jesus as possible. By the way, yeah, I follow him all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
We eat together.
He's my best friend.
Yeah, exactly. He's my best friend.
Even before he was famous.
Yeah, just like, right, even, I would, right. And all the pictures I would put in my head, like, just like on a Facebook selfie.
But I think, too, you know, Jesus is trying to give them a warning of, like, mm-hmm. beware that you don't think more of yourself than you ought. Mm. That now that, you know, because you chose to follow me, or because you think that this multitude is here for you. Mm. And so Jesus is like, calm down, chill.
This is so yeah. true, because, like, look, they were just talking about Pharisees, but now what they notice, they notice that the group of Pharisees is not as, the multitude is not that big. Mm-hmm. Mm. The amount of people that follow Jesus now is larger than the Pharisees. Yes. So what can happen? Of course, they become just like other hypocrites.
Right.
Yeah.
And Jesus warns them and says, no, beware.
But I think it's powerful when you look at the whole theme of hypocrisy that we explored in the last episode was given to civic leaders and religious leaders, Pharisees. Mm. And now we have a whole crowd is here, and he again warns them to be careful and guard their hearts against hypocrisy. It should be really a warning sign, even to us here, you know, that are a part of a Hope Channel ministry, that sometimes when you're in a position of religious influence, and I don't know how you want to describe it, you are especially susceptible to one of the worst things that can happen to a human being's soul, which is hypocrisy. So it's just important to be careful against it. You're actually especially susceptible and vulnerable.
Exactly, and it applies to us personally and also to Christianity in general.
Yes. Yes. Yep.
Because the entire world can be drawn to Jesus if we stop being hypocrites.
Yes. Yes. Well,
and that's why people will start trampling one over another, because they would be willing to be closer to Jesus if we were not hypocrites. So that is why we will stop being hypocrites. Let's move forward. So Luke chapter 2 verses 4 and 5, and Marlon, could you read verses 4 and 5 and then 6 and 7?
Okay.
Yes.
It says, and I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body and after that have no more that they can do. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who, after he has killed, has power to cast into hell. Yes, I say to you, fear him. After not five sparrows sold for 2 copper coins, and not one of them is forgotten before God, but the very hairs on your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. Also, I say to you, whoever confess me before men, him the Son of Man also will confess before the angels of God.
Okay, you got so excited that you could pretty much read the entire chapter. Yeah. This is good. No, this is good. So this is what happens here. We see how Jesus again teaches the fear, about the fear and not fear. Mm-hmm. And in some Bibles it says the fear of God.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. Let's explore it again. Mm-hmm. Look what happens. Look what it says in verse 5. And so verse 4, and I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of whom?
Those who kill the body.
So who you shouldn't be afraid of?
Man.
Man. Mm-hmm. Okay, let me just ask you a question before that. When it comes to hypocrisy, why are we hypocritical? Mm. What is the root of that hypocrisy?
Because we care how people perceive us or what light they see us in.
Yeah. Isn't that so?
Yeah. Yes.
Because we put masks, why? Because we want approval of others.
Mm. Yeah. Right.
Yeah, we become hypocrites because, okay, I'm better than somebody else. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this is like, so people care about everybody's opinion. Mm-hmm. But then, so Jesus says, stop being hypocrites. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do the will of God. Mm-hmm. And then he continues in verse 4, what you just read. Mm-hmm. My friends, do not be afraid of those who can kill what?
The body.
The body. So stop being hypocrites. Mm-hmm. Even if they what? kill you. Mm-hmm. Stop being hypocrites, even if they kill you. Mm-hmm. But I will show, but what verse 5 says? What Sergio, could you read verse 5 again?
But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who, after he has killed, has power to cast into hell. Yes, I say to you, fear him.
Mm. So who do we need to fear then?
God. Capital G.
Really?
Yes.
Why do you think so? Okay, for God, verse 5. Let's read verse 7 now. Mm-hmm. Verse 7. Claudia, could you read verse 7?
But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore. You are of more value than many sparrows. Mm.
So why do you think God is saying, like, fear me? Because I can cast you to hell?
Well, just to recap this whole passage. So you're said, don't fear those that can kill your body.
Yes.
Those people outside you're trying to impress. Then it says, fear him who after he has killed has power to cast into hell. Fear him, whoever this person is. Mm-hmm. Then there's a third party that is presented as someone who is so compassionate and loving that he even knows sparrows, which are worthless, almost worthless in that culture. And even has the heads on your hair number. So he's presented in contrast to whoever this middle figure is.
Yes. Yeah. So do you see it again? So Sergio, thank you so much for this recap. This is just amazing. Otherwise, I would have been lost myself. This is very important. So there is somebody who you can fear. People, approval. Then this second person. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then...
Then God, presented as separate from whatever that middle thing is.
Yeah. So and from the first one. Mm-hmm. So who do you think the second one is?
Well, I guess like I kind of saw it as almost like an option, right? So I felt like Luke was saying like, I don't think you should fear, but if you're going to fear, at least fear the person that has control over your eternal life rather than your temporal life.
Okay, but have you ever heard about God throwing people into hell?
Yeah.
Or God killing people?
Oh, God killing people?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, the book of Genesis probably. Yeah, this is true. Yes. Yeah. But wait a second, because here in this verse specifically, we see that first of all, hell does not exist in those terms because if you read this passage carefully, the word that is used here, Gehenna, Gehenna means a pit that is outside the city. This is exactly the place where back in the days, which is Old Testament times, people would sacrifice children to a pagan god. So after that, what they would do, they would throw people of, not just bodies, but bodies of criminals and somebody else to that pit, which is like, it was just a garbage bin.
It was the actual name of a trash heap outside of Jerusalem.
Exactly. Yeah. It's an actual name of a trash heap outside Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Wow. Later on in history, we decided, Christians, throughout the ages and generations and thousands of years of traditions, what we decided to do, we decided to subscribe to the idea of hell.
Yeah. The Greek
and this is exactly what Plato, Greek idea of hell, Plato presented to us, this beautiful idea of hell. I don't know how beautiful it is, about the second world or third world, and that's why we read in mythology, Greek mythology, that there is hell.
Hades.
So Christianity, Hades, exactly. Christianity, like a sponge, absorbed it.
Yeah. Mm.
So when we read this verse, we constantly attribute this verse to God. Mm. Because it says hell. Who can throw you to hell? God, we say. But in fact, if you read this passage carefully, you will see that how can it contradict itself? Mm. Because the next verse, verse 5, says, who can throw you into hell?
Mm. And then a very compassionate, loving God who knows so much about you that even the hairs on your head are
numbered. On your head. So whoever that is, maybe it's Satan, maybe it's something else. I don't know. Maybe you know who it is. If you disagree, just let us know.
Maybe it's us.
Maybe it's us, yeah. Because there are people who can kill you. Mm. Others, maybe it's Satan, maybe it's something else. They can throw you out of the city. Mm. But trust God, because he knows the numbers of your hair. Mm. Trust God, because he takes care of his sparrows.
Even those sparrows that are worth next to nothing, he sees them.
Exactly. Yeah. Wow. And that is why I will not be a hypocrite, because I do not seek for approval of people. Mm. And even if I die, E, because he knows my hairs. He will raise me up. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, this is over time for me, I guess. Thank you for joining us, but don't go anywhere because we will continue our discussion after this short break.
That's right, and as people always say, it's best to learn from other people's mistakes. And coming up, someone's about to make such a big mistake that God himself calls him a fool. So stick with us so we can learn from that together.
Welcome back to Cross Connection. In Luke chapter 12, it's just, isn't it incredible?
Yeah.
In Luke chapter 11, we learned that there is a need of internal transformation. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Then we learned about hypocrisy. Mm-hmm.
And now the outer presentation.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And then we see how Jesus is saying, beware of that hypocrisy. Mm-hmm. Because hypocrisy is ultimately the seeking of approval of others, as Marlon was saying. Mm-hmm. So we try to seek that approval. And then Jesus says, do not even worry about those who can kill your body. Mm-hmm. Worry about that person or that whoever that may be who can throw you into this hell. Mm-hmm. But we learned that hell is not actually hell that we think of hell.
Right. I mean, it goes into not even an interpretation issue. The actual word, as you highlighted, Oleg, was Gehenna, which is a specific place outside of Jerusalem that you would throw dead bodies, you'd throw trash or whatever. And so, especially to the people Jesus was talking to in the early readers of the Gospels, they would not have thought of this Greek abstraction where you go to suffer forever. Mm-hmm. They would have thought, yeah, that place outside Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in other words, Jesus continues to elaborate, by the way, don't worry about your body ultimately. Mm. Mm-hmm. Trust, and then he continued in verse 6, mm-hmm. trust God who knows sparrows, which are sold for so little, and none of them is forgotten. Mm. Mm-hmm. And then he continued, and by the way, I know even how many hairs, Jutesh, you have.
And the very last line, you are more valuable than many sparrows. If I have something that's value to me, why am I going to throw it into the trash? Why am I going to throw it into hell? Mm-hmm. You know, if something has value to me, I'm going to treasure it and I'm going to do everything that I can to keep it. And that's how God is being presented here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, like, as I was thinking about it too, like, you guys, I felt like it was almost borderline obsessive. Mm-hmm. Because I feel like, you know, like, if, like, a guy was to come up to me and say, like, Claudia, you know, like, I know I know how many numbers, you know, how many hair numbers are on your head, you know, it's like, that's kind of weird.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's like, you know, like, you know, why would Luke go through so much trouble to almost kind of present God as almost, like, obsessive over us?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But isn't it beautiful?
Yeah.
It's obsessive, but at the same time, it's just, wow, he loves us so much.
Yeah.
My mom doesn't know how many.
Well, I never say, if, you know, to refer to this guy in this example, this guy that even knows the hairs on your head, he's not going to kill you.
Yeah. Right.
He would never, you know, just get rid of you, you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, in this extreme love, certainly why would he just throw us away like garbage into this trash heap?
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely.
Yeah, excellent. So then we move forward, which is the dilemma, decision. We need to decide where to be, on which side to be. And let's read verses 8 through 12. And Claudia, could you read verses 8 through 12 for us?
Sure.
So we are in Luke chapter 12, 8 through 12.
Also, I say to you, whoever confesses me before men, him the Son of Man also will confess before the angels of God. But he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. Mm. And anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But to him who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven. Now, when they bring you to the synagogues and magistrates and authorities, do not worry about how or what you should answer or what you should say. For the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. So Christians for years, and we for years, we try to understand what is the meaning of this, like, to blasphemy against the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And there are some debates, of course, and we can contribute also only to this debate. Mm-hmm. And so what do you think is happening here, and what do you think that sin against the Holy Spirit or blasphemy against the Holy Spirit might.
Well, what I'll say before we get into that discussion is to keep in mind, again, two studies ago, an internal transformation, the Ninevites and how they were forgiven. Mm-hmm. You know, and these were people, as you highlighted, Oleg, that they were so depraved that they would even line their pyramids with human skin. I mean, they were just like all kinds of grotesque, depraved things. And God Jesus highlights them as an example because they accepted forgiveness. They asked for forgiveness. And so when you think that really there doesn't seem to be any extent that we're able to sin, that God is not willing to forgive us, I think that needs to be at the forefront of our minds as we engage in this debate as to what it means to blaspheme against the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Absolutely, and that is very important because sometimes we say, oh, I sinned against the Holy Spirit. I will never be forgiven. And you know, if somebody tells you that you sinned against the Holy Spirit, you will never be forgiven, tell them, no, I know that Jesus will forgive me. I know that Jesus will forgive me. Because when people say you sinned against the Holy Spirit, you will never be forgiven, they don't know what they're talking about.
That's
Because and ultimately, exactly the same study that we had, Sergio, that you alluded to, it's in chapter 11.
Yes.
And then verse 13. We need to read verse 13, chapter 11, verse 13. Marlon, could you read verse 13 for us?
Yes, I can. It says, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?
Okay, so look what happens here. So here the Holy Spirit is given to those who ask him. So, and then in chapter 12, verse 10, we read this blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. So if the Holy Spirit is given to those who ask, so if you blaspheme against the Holy Spirit, if you just reject the Holy Spirit.
Because we see then two verses later in verse 12 of chapter 12, it says, for the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say.
Right.
So the Holy Spirit is something that we ask for. The Holy Spirit is something that when we receive it, works upon our heart to change us even in ways that we don't expect. So we run into that this unpardonable sin thing. Well then, yeah, if I'm rejecting the Holy Spirit, if the Holy Spirit is God's mechanism to work on my heart, to forgive me, to change me, to internally transform me, how can I be internally transformed if I'm blocking the very mechanism through which God uses to change me?
That is it. That is the end of conversation. That is it. Because this is exactly what happens.
That's right.
And so if I blaspheme the tool that transforms, changes me, of course. I just it's gonna be with me.
It reminds me of a scripture, and I don't remember the reference of it, but it says something along the line. It's the mystery of God is God in you, the hope of glory. So it's like Christ died, and then he sent the Comforter. And so when God sent his Holy Spirit, the Comforter, he's able to live out his life in us. In other words, we can live how Christ wants us to live by that Holy Spirit being in us. But if we reject that, we reject the mechanism by which we can be saved.
Absolutely, absolutely. So so whenever if somebody tells you, you sinned against the Holy Spirit, you say, no, because I do not reject Jesus Christ. I did sin, but it doesn't, but I want to be changed. And even if seven demons are within me, I know that if I repent, they will be gone again.
It's just, we keep referencing that study, but it was such an important one. The internal transformation was presented as something that there's an external, you know, force that ignites that chemical reaction with us, so to speak, that causes that transformation. So if we remove that, how can we expect it to happen?
Excellent. Oh, I remember. Because we have a hidden treasure, actually.
Oh, great.
I completely forgot about it. So yeah, it's in it's the parable that is ahead of us, the parable of the rich fool. Remember, we talked about the hell and everything else, but now we will come to a very practical application of that. And so what we will do, we will watch this hidden treasure now. Are you excited about it? Let's do it.
In Luke 12, we read about a man approaching Jesus with a legitimate request to help to divide the wealth between him and his brother. Instead of judging, Jesus tells a parable that became one of Jesus' primary teachings on the subject of wealth and private property. And that's the subject of today's hidden treasure. There are three main lessons that we can learn from this parable. Firstly, the parable starts with a very clear and important point. The ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. It is the ground that belongs to God that yielded, and not even the work of the rich man. How often do we think that it was all us, when in fact it was God's hand in our life? Secondly, Jesus presents that this rich man was all about himself. In fact, he is presented as living in isolation from the human family around him. And the only person with whom he can have a dialogue is himself. He reasons in himself, "What shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops?" How often do we see a sad picture? When people acquire more wealth, the farther they become withdrawn from their neighbors. Thirdly, in this parable, we see one of the major, often hidden truths of the Bible. Life is a gift. No matter how many days or years of life we are given, we need to be grateful for those days or years. We are given the gift of life and we ought to live it justly and rightfully. We need to remember that we are here not to acquire wealth, but to share it and bless others. After all, the abundant life is to be found in treasuring up for God rather than for self. And that's today's hidden treasure.
So there are three lessons that we can learn from this story. And Sergio, I would like us to go deeper into this and just do a recap of the story again.
Okay.
So that we can learn those three lessons very well.
A quick text.
Yes.
Right. This is the parable of the rich fool, Luke 12:13-21. Someone asked Jesus to tell his brother to divide his inheritance with him. Jesus responds, "Who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" and warns to guard against greed. He tells a parable of a rich man whose property yielded an abundant harvest. And to accommodate the excess crops, he plans to tear down his old barns and build bigger ones so that he can take life easy. God says to him, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself?" Jesus concludes that this is how it will be for those who only store things up for themselves but are not rich with God.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. So We see this progression in the chapter 12. First, people are gathered, make a decision. Beware of hypocrisy. Mm-hmm. Secondly, remember you can trust God even if they want to kill your body, if they want to throw you outside of Jerusalem into this place that is called Gehenna, which is translated in our Bibles as hell. Mm-hmm. Even if they want to throw you there, don't worry about it because God knows the amount of hair that you have. Yeah. Then it continues and says, confess Jesus Christ before man and everybody. Yes. Mm-hmm. And do not resist the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Let him work within you. Mm-hmm. And then this parable. This parable that presents three very distinctive lessons. Mm-hmm. First lesson, blessings come from God.
Amen. Amen. Yeah.
Only from God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Second, because this is what hypocrites sometimes think.
Yeah.
No, blessings come from me.
Hard work. Yeah.
From my hard work.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Secondly, secondly, egoism is our nature.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And this is exactly why hypocrisy is present. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Because egoism is our nature. Yeah. And the third one, life is the greatest gift from God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen.
And that is why we need to lay our treasures where? Sergio, you said.
In heaven.
Yeah, towards God.
Yeah.
Towards God. So how do you see these three lessons that we learned from this parable can help us?
Well, if I just want to tie something to what you went over with the Gehenna hell situation, we apply this like insane schizophrenic duality to God. Mm-hmm. We say that he's so compassionate and he loves you and he'll do it. His son died for you, but if you sin, he's going to throw you into hell. Yeah. We have this insane duality. And we have this here, too, where I think a lot of times when we read this story, we'll say, okay, God bless this man. But then also when he says, this night your soul will be required of you, that's God saying, okay, now because you did this, I'm gonna kill you now. I'm going to condemn you to hell. And we assign both things to God. But as you highlighted, you know, God is the one who provides good things. God is the one who blesses. Yeah. God is the one who provides life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
So how important for us to remember these things? Mm.
Absolutely.
Yeah, how important it is for us to remember that blessings come from God, not from us.
Yeah. Yes.
And that I feel like when you think about it like that, then it kind of places you in the realm of stewardship. Mm-hmm. Because then I'm not trying to be greedy and hoard all of these things
it's
for
not
myself.
Of me. Yeah.
It's not of me. Yeah. I didn't do it. Yeah. So, like, if you need grain, I'm going to give you grain because I didn't get the grain by myself, you know? And so I think when you understand that these things are from God, then you then ultimately use them for God.
That's powerful.
Yeah. And that is exactly what the prayer of Jesus was about. Mm. Remember, our Father in heaven. Mm. Yeah. It doesn't say my Father.
Yes. Wow.
It says our Father in heaven. Mm. Yes. That means that if somebody needs bread, I will give them bread.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And this is exactly what this gentleman
you
did.
You forgave me, so I want to forgive those around me.
Exactly, yeah. And that is exactly what we see on the pages of the Gospels. We will continue our conversation after this short break.
That's right, and if you've ever felt stressed, I know I have, but Jesus actually says that a defining characteristic of his people should be that they don't worry. The way to remove stress from your life is coming up.
Welcome back. The study of the Word of God sets our hearts on fire.
Yes,
absolutely. And I hope you feel the same. So we've talked about the parable of the rich fool.
Mm-hmm.
And in this parable, we cannot allegorize it and just say what grain means, etc., because that was not the point.
Yeah. Yeah.
The point is that we do have, we need to understand these three lessons. Yeah. Blessings come from God,
right,
not from you yourself, because that is the conclusion of the text.
Yeah.
So is he who lays up treasures in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
So second, blessings come from God. Secondly, which is very important, we need to remember that ego is our nature.
Mm. Yeah.
This is what we do. We constantly pretend that everything is around should be us and only us. And the third lesson that we also need to remind ourselves of is that God gives us life.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Can I add a fourth lesson to that?
Sure. Absolutely.
Is that these blessings are given not so that you store them up for yourself,
yes,
but so that you can share them with the people around.
Yes.
That's exactly
absolutely
why God gave it to you,
right,
so that you could be the steward of this awesome thing that he's, yes, put into the world, now distribute it to people.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And that's why he was so upset. That's what made him a fool, that, mm-hmm, he just stored it up for himself.
Yeah.
So if we try to get rid of those three elements with the help of Jesus Christ in our lives, mm, who works in us with in the form of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
And because this passage follows, mm, the passage on the Holy Spirit.
Yes. Mm.
You let him work, and then this is what happens. You will not see this foolishness in you.
Yes. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
So then we go to another point, which is very important. And anxiety is probably
hugely important. Yeah.
Hugely important.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Anxiety is probably one of the hugest issues in our society.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Because whenever you look at somebody, like somebody in the eyes, you see the anxiety.
Yeah.
I don't see it in Marlon's eyes, but but you see it. Yeah. You see it everywhere. People are anxious.
Yeah, it's funny that, you know, probably the two biggest contributors to poor health are lack of rest,
mm-hmm,
and stress.
Yeah.
And those are two things that we see the Bible talk about over and over and over again, even commandments to engage in rest and to not engage in worrying.
Because the seventh day was given for us to rest.
Yes. Absolutely.
Yeah. Sabbath rest.
Yeah.
And that's why God is constantly reminding us about not being worried.
Yeah. Yeah.
So let's Sergio, could you present to us a quick text on this very issue?
This is Luke 12, 22 through 34. So Jesus teaches to not worry about your life and its worries, because life is about much more than that. Mm. He gives a bunch of examples. The birds don't store up food like the fool did, yet God feeds them. He will do much more for you. The wild flowers don't labor, yet God adorns them. He will do much more for you. Can you add even 1 hour to your life by worrying? Mm. Then why worry? The pagan world runs around worrying. Don't be like that. Instead, seek his kingdom, and all these things will be given to you as well. God is pleased to give you the kingdom, so sell your possessions and give to the poor. Build up treasure in heaven instead. And the final line of our passage today is, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So this is perhaps one of the most important lessons that we can learn today.
Yeah.
How can we live without this anxiety? And why do you think Jesus is presenting to us these lily of the valley?
Mm-hmm.
Lilies of the valley.
Well, I guess, like, to your first question, you know, I find it so interesting that, you know, Luke is just so sequential, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he begins with prayer, mm-hmm, then he goes into hypocrisy, and now he's going into worry.
Mm-hmm.
And so I feel like the reason that we shouldn't worry, or ways to not worry, is that if we're praying,
mm-hmm,
then we've accepted the Holy Spirit, and then I'm not living for other people. Mm-hmm. And so when I'm not trying to impress other people, then I'm not worried and anxious about what I'm going to put on,
mm-hmm,
or what I'm going to eat, mm-hmm, or what I'm going to do, mm-hmm, because I am literally living every moment of my life for Christ, believing that everything that he does in my life is only through his power.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't worry about anything.
Yeah. Awesome.
This is incredible. Yeah. Continue.
expand on that. Well, you know, I think this ties to our fourth guest question for today, which is, why do we have such a hard time trusting God? Because if we were to fully trust God, anxiety would be completely removed from our lives. Mm-hmm. I'm going to take a comment from Lewis, and it sounds like overly simple, but I think it's quite profound. Lewis gets to it, says, because of our sinful nature. And to me, that takes us all the way back to when sin first entered into our midst. And sin was a separation from God. That's what sin is at its core. So of course, if our nature is to be separated from God, and separation from God can be what causes us to not trust Him, to have so much anxiety and so much stress, then I need to be looking at these things that He's offering to reconnect us, the Holy Spirit, to transform me so that I can rely on Him and trust Him.
But so with anxiety, for me, if I deal with it in my life, it's like, what's the opposite of anxiety, or what's the opposite of not worrying? I mean, of worrying. It's not worrying. How do you not worry? Is you have to have faith in something else, right?
Yeah.
So you have to have faith in something else to take care of you. So our nature is to find something else in this world to have faith in.
Wow.
And that's, and the thing is, there's nothing on this in this world that can be faithful back to us, that can actually is strong enough that we can put our faith in it, and it will return back to us.
Awesome.
There's only one thing that we can do that, and that's God. Because that comes from Him. Love comes from Him. Faith comes from Him. Have faith in Him, and He won't let you down.
Yes.
Can I take it back a little bit to Genesis? Because when you were talking, Sergio, it kind of like brought my memory back to Genesis. Because when our foreparents, Adam and Eve, sinned, the first thing that they did was fear, right? They hid from God. Yeah. The Bible actually says fear, I know, in the King James, because that's the one I have. And we know that perfect love casted out fear. And that perfect love is God, because God is love. So when you put your faith on the rock, right, on Jesus Christ, that love, then you won't have that anxiety and that fear. You can build your faith. You can build your life around love, which
is
God.
This is so powerful.
The thing is, if you try it, you'll know the difference. There's a difference between putting faith in something that can't return to you and when you put it in God. Try it in your own life and see the difference that you'll see.
And this is why we can look at the lilies of the field, because they are literally an example within nature of total dependence upon God. And so it's like every time I try to do something on my own or work something of my own power, and it doesn't really work out the way that I feel like it should work out, because ultimately I'm not totally depending on God, I can actually look at a bird and realize that they don't worry about it. They know that no matter what the season is, no matter what the weather is, they are going to have food for that day.
And as a person that like animals, you look at them, they're so beautiful, right? All the colors and all these different things, and they're not even worrying. A flower, for instance, is so beautiful. Everything is in its place, but it's not worrying. It's just receiving the blessings from God.
You know, along those lines, I want to take a comment from Stacy to our fourth guest question. And, you know, as we have this conversation, important to keep in mind that this sounds great. It's not easy, guys. Like, we're talking about, like, very simple, you know, expressions. This is not easy. And Stacy prescribes why. Because it takes patience and a willingness to be vulnerable. When we yield and submit to God, we are relinquishing our perceived power to Him. If we have to trust Him with something that takes a long time to be resolved, we grow more anxious as our patience wears thin. Combat this by dwelling on His promises in Scripture and how He has led in our lives personally. We have to remind ourselves that God is never late. His time and His wisdom is always perfect. So it's not easy. Even when we know God is good, it's not easy.
That's right. Because, you know, every day in my own life, you know, I said, okay, you can either worry or you can have faith, right? I don't say it the beginning of the week, and then at the end of the week, I'm the same where I was. This is every time you worry, which is going to happen constantly in your life. Stop, pause. Lord, I choose to have faith in You instead of worrying, because I can't do both. If I'm worrying, I don't have faith in You. I don't know that You're going to take care of this for me. But if I stop and rely on Your faith and just have faith in You, it's going to be taken care of. I don't need to worry about it anymore.
That's powerful, and that you say daily, you know, because earlier we had deny yourself, take up your cross daily. I think this is part of that, part of the denying yourself. Stop trying to take care of it yourself. Deny that, and instead trust that God is going to take care of it.
It's just, I just love it. Continue. This is amazing, because what we see is just, we can summarize it in one question. Who do you trust, or what do you trust?
Exactly.
Where is your heart?
Where is your heart? Exactly. That's where is your heart? Because you can trust people who can kill you. You can trust that person who can throw you out on the garbage pit, because you can try to please them. You can trust you can trust money. You can trust yourself. You can trust your grains. God says, you know what? Do not trust
any of those, mm-hmm. but trust in me. Yeah. And then you will be worry-free.
That's yes. right. Yeah.
And I think it's like within our nature to trust in ourselves. Mm-hmm. It is within our nature to literally believe that we have the power to make our lives whatever that is. And particularly within this particular culture now, you know, we're very individualistic. Yeah. We're very, very focused on what do I need to do? When do I need to do it? And so for God to then kind of command you to do something that is literally against all culture, against all, you know, your normal makeup, it's like, no, it is not easy for me to have faith in God. And so because of that, it is easy for me to then fear, you know, what I don't necessarily have control of.
You know how we talked about how lilies of the valley and then flowers and how it does its thing, and we can see that it's just, it knows what it's doing. It has faith, right? We need to become those lilies of the valley. We need to be that flower. And the only way we can do that is when we have faith. People are wondering, why are you not worrying? You have this big problem ahead of you. I don't see your stress. I don't see your anxiety. Why are you not worried? And it's because you have that faith. And they ask you, and then you can spread that to somebody else.
Jithesh, I think you hit the nail on the head there, because Jesus seems to make a special point to say, don't worry, don't worry. In fact, he kind of presents it here in a way that it needs to define us as his followers. He says, the pagan world worries. You need to not, because it can be a witness of God's power to people's lives around you. So that's more important, just even for your own intellectual peace of mind. It's important so that other people can see, you know what, this guy has something powerful. There is a God in heaven, and he can have my back.
Amen.
But what's cool too is that, like, I feel like he doesn't just say don't worry and then not tell you how to not do it.
Exactly.
You know, because he's then like, seek first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness, and then everything will come unto you.
Yeah.
You know?
Let's just do it. Let's read it. Let's just go to it. Verse 29 through 31. And could you read for us, Claudia?
Sure.
29 through 31.
And do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink, nor have an anxious mind. For all these things the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows that you need these things. But seek the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added to you.
Mm. Yeah, I would like us to make sure to highlight these verses.
Yeah.
Just highlight these verses. Remember that they're in Luke chapter 12. We memorized it. 29 through 31. Yeah. This is exactly where you can just come to it, and whenever you go through financial problems, whatever that may be, just come to this and just read. You know what? God will provide.
Yes. Amen.
Because even when you had only $5 to live on the entire week, or the entire month, God will provide. God will provide.
Yes. Didn't Paul say that God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him?
Yes. You know,
that needs to be our only concern. Mm-hmm. Stop worrying about all these other things. And this is exactly what Jesus is saying here in Luke. Seek after, and everything else will get taken care of. It's such a huge leap to make, because it's such really incredible news that He's promising. But if we can make that leap, it's just make the world of difference in our lives.
But we also need to remember, we cannot just be individualistic and make that leap, because it's possible not to worry. It's available for those who are the disciples of Jesus, which means they live in the kingdom of God. What that means, that I have mother and father in this community also. And that is the community that will be acting on behalf of God by sharing their bread.
I have Jithesh and Claudia and Marlon here to help me through this.
Exactly. Yeah. And they will come. If they know that I'm in need of bread, they will come. Won't you come?
Yes, of course.
Won't you invite me to dinner if I need it?
Of course.
So, or if I need a sleep,
because you're not storing your grain in your storerooms.
By yourself.
Because you're willing to share it.
And that is why we learned that it is such a blessing to be connected with the community of believers.
Yes.
And that is why we are disciples.
Yeah.
And we are brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers.
We help each other along.
Absolutely. And that is why if you feel that you're by yourself, alone, watching this program, and you're not connected to a community of believers, those who are disciples of Jesus Christ, not just hypocrites, because we all want to be genuine in our Christianity. Make sure to write to us. Let us know where you, what city you live in, and we will make sure to send you the address and the telephone number of a community of believers that can cherish you, love you, and help you if the help is needed. But don't go anywhere. We will continue our conversation after this break.
That's right, and we'll continue to explore our theme of Where Is Your Heart with some great insights from you, our fourth guest.
Welcome back. We are discussing this idea, where is your heart?
Yes. Yeah.
And it's presented in Luke chapter 12. And we saw how at the very beginning Jesus emphasizes, do not worry about what people think about you.
Yes. Yes.
In other words, do not be a hypocrite.
Yes. Right.
Trust God. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And let the Holy Spirit enter your heart. Do not blaspheme against the Holy Spirit, which means reject.
Yes.
Do not reject. And then we also learned on this parable of the rich fool. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be a rich fool. I don't want to be a fool. Rich is fine. No, I don't want to be a rich fool. Because basically, when you try to collect this grain only for yourself, because Jesus emphasizes the fact that we shouldn't worry.
Yeah.
We shouldn't worry just like lilies of the fields.
But I love that that selfish attitude is presented as foolishness.
Mm-hmm.
It's just dumb. Why are you doing that? In fact, the reason he says he wants to do that is just so he can eat and drink and be merry. Just like, just literally do nothing. Yeah. Like, I'm just going to sit here and enjoy, like, just do nothing for the rest of my life. Mm-hmm. That's foolish. Mm-hmm. Like, wouldn't you rather make someone else happier? Mm-hmm. Wouldn't you rather, like, give someone else life? Mm-hmm. Allow them to continue to live a happy life or give them a happy life if they don't have one until now? One choice is just kind of foolish compared to the other. Yeah,
definitely.
But we see how Jesus emphasizes and re-emphasizes the fact that we shouldn't worry, shouldn't be anxious.
Mm. Yes.
So why do you think Jesus is so concerned? Why isn't he about us?
There's an absence of peace when you're anxious and when you worry. Because I mean, like, even as you guys were talking before the break, like, I really just thought of, I think it's like Philippians 4, where it says to just be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God, so that the peace of God can truly just surpass all of your understanding. And so God is so concerned about our health that he doesn't even want us to be stressed, because when we're stressed, we have no peace and we're anxious, we can't sleep, you know, like, we're just stressed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think of two things that we've seen in Luke leading up till now. The first is, as we've gone over, how clear Jesus makes it that God wants to give good things to his children. Yeah. Like, how much God wants to give good things to his children. And the other is when Jesus is rejoicing to God, who he's thanking him, that he has been able to reveal God to them. He's been able to reveal the Father to them. And that really ties to maybe why some of us aren't able to trust. I'll take a few comments. Mm-hmm. And it relates to not knowing God. Raymond says, we don't know him. That's why we don't trust him. Mm-hmm. Nina Lee gives a very similar comment. She says, I think it's in a person's nature not to trust someone that they may not truly know. And Miguel saying the same thing, this trust issue. We don't fully trust him because most of us know of him and we don't really know him on a personal level. Knowing Jesus is the foundation of a real Christian walk. So how can you trust someone that you don't know? The key first is to know God.
Wow. So like a real life application of that would be, say for instance, you're in a relationship or a significant other. For me, I have my wife, right? There are certain things that I just don't worry about that I know that she's going to take care of. We love each other so much, and we've learned that there are roles and things that we do, and immediately it's like, I know, I don't need to worry. I know she's going to take care of that. So let's just say we have that same love for the person who invented love, who created love.
Who is love.
Who is love, and who sacrificed and showed that love to us. Imagine if we were to put faith, why do we need to worry then? That's what he's saying, I created you, and I love you so much, there's no need to worry. It's like, it's against everything I believe in, because have faith in me. If you know me, if you love me, you don't need to worry about anything.
Absolutely. But I feel like sometimes people don't really like understand who God is.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And they don't understand who Jesus is. They don't really understand his nature.
That's right.
And so to some degree, like, we can say, man, like, God is love. Mm-hmm. But because I don't really necessarily understand that, then I fear it.
Exactly.
Like, I heard, I read this thing where it said, like, humanity either fears or worships that which it does not understand.
Mm-hmm.
And so literally, I feel like that is religion. Like, those of us that actually feel like we understand God or try to learn his nature, we worship him and we love him. But those of us that don't, we're afraid of him.
Yes, very true.
And we find it difficult to trust in him.
That's right.
You know, I keep going back to what Jithesh said earlier in my mind, because this isn't to guilt trip people that get anxious, because we've all gotten anxious.
Yes.
You know,
exactly.
We'd be hypocrites to say that we don't. Even against our better judgment, we get anxious and we get stressed about things.
Absolutely.
But it's so important to not, because it can be a witness to other people around us you know what, that maybe there is something. I used to think, I was skeptical of Jithesh's beliefs, but now I see how calm he is in the face of this storm in life. I see that somehow mysteriously he's being led through this storm. I don't know how, but I want to at least, now I'm at least curious curious to see what he has. Exactly. That could be the most powerful witnessing tool for people. So it's so important that we try and liberate ourselves from this anxiety and really trust God.
Yeah, and that is exactly why we will finish our discussion today reading this passage. Just three verses, verses 32 through 34. So, Claudia, could you read 32 through 34? We're in Luke chapter 12.
Do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell what you have and give alms. Provide yourselves money bags which do not grow old, a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches nor moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
So, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And this is just the conclusion of our talk or our discussion about where we want our heart to be. Either we choose internal transformation and full dependence on God, or we choose people, and then we become hypocrites.
You know, this makes me think of one of my favorite poems, which is Ozymandias, where a man comes across a desert and sees this kind of broken, what used to be a statue of this great and powerful man, you know, and it's gaze upon my works, ye mighty, in despair. It's so confident, like, look at all of this I've built for myself, and now it's just torn and broken to the ground, you know. And if you don't have this belief, it can be a very kind of depressing worldview that no matter what we do, the sands of time are eventually going to just wipe it away. But then it becomes really good news through here when we say, the world's just, it's just, the sands of time are going to erode whatever you do here, whatever you collect for yourself. Store up treasures in heaven, and that'll be eternal. That'll be something lasting and real for you.
Absolutely.
Yes. And the treasures in heaven are collected by discipleship. Discipleship for the kingdom. When the gospel of the kingdom is preached, when our internal transformation is observed, when we go and share our bread, when we go and forgive others, when we spread the love, when we do everything so that we can experience the kingdom of heaven now and for eternity.
I really appreciate that, because I feel like a lot of people, like, when they talk about this text, like, they always talk about it as in, like, oh, well, like, where you put your money in, that's where, you know, your heart is and whatnot. But I appreciate that. I feel like this text, like what you were bringing out, is talking about priority, like what your heart prioritizes. When your heart prioritizes the things of God, that is what we're supposed to be trying to aim
because, after. Because it even says where your treasure is. Treasure does not necessarily mean money. Treasure is anything, whatever the treasure is.
Right. With value.
What you
value.
Hold dear.
What if it's public opinion? Maybe you this is your what value
power.
Maybe just desire to please others or many other things. This is what God wants us to completely just these traditions he want to destroy. Okay, so we have only 2 minutes left. So what is your takeaway lesson? And let's start with our viewers.
Sure, I'll take a comment here from Doug, talking about the need to get rid of the self. Doug says, no matter how much we say we trust God, our flawed human nature just naturally makes us say, what do I have to do to fix this mess? What do I do to make this happen? How can I decide what direction to go? You notice the word I in all those questions. Substitute the word God, and things will start to happen. It's just giving up all of these things that we want to do in order to fix things and let God take care of it for us.
Yeah.
So it's very, very powerful for me, but ultimately, it comes back again to worrying every day and having anxiety. It's just you can either have faith or you can worry. You can't. They both don't work together. So for those out there, just like me, who deal with that, have faith and learn about what it is to have faith in the person who really loves you.
Absolutely. And I guess, like, I mean, like, for me, like, I'm, you know, in grad school, I'm worried about my thesis right now, and so it was just really encouraging for me to kind of read and have Christ really just say, like, Claudia, like, look at nature and see how they have total dependence upon me. And I really want you to have that same kind of dependence on me as well.
It doesn't mean that you shouldn't write your thesis.
No.
It will not be written by itself.
Yeah, he's not going to write it for me.
But trust in him, he will give you wisdom.
Yeah. Right.
Now, that would be storing your ideas in the storeroom of your head. You see, so you don't want to do that. You want to share it with the world.
Share with the world. Write it down. On paper.
Yeah, exactly.
And for me, you know, it's just
my family and I were looking to buy a house, and we're kind of worrying about where we should go. And at first, when something came on the market, we didn't have that peace, so we were like, this can't be where we should be. So we backed up. We actually fast and pray about it. And then we started reading this book called Country Living, and then we're saying, is that what God wants for us? Mm-hmm. And so this lesson came in right on time, and I believe that God is speaking to my heart to don't worry about it. Mm-hmm. You know, if He's able to provide for the sparrow and give them direction, then He'll give us direction in where we need to go. So I guess the last thing I want to say is that, you know, just letting go and let God's Holy Spirit work through us and give us and guide us into where He wants us to be.
Awesome. You do your part and God will cover everything else.
Yes.
This is incredible. Thank you so much. I was truly blessed, and I hope you were also blessed. Jesus clearly states that you cannot trust both this world and Him. After all, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So put your trust in Jesus fully and unconditionally, and experience real freedom from anxiety and fear. Until next week, trust Jesus in your everyday life and here on Cross Connection.